I'm Caroline Dowd Higgins. Thank you for listening to Your Working Life, my podcast series featuring thought leaders in the career and personal growth arena. I know that you spend a significant portion of your life at work, so I'm on a mission to provide you with tools, inspiration, and resources so you can enjoy your career and love your life. And I'm delighted to welcome my very special guest to the show today, Karen Kelski. Karen, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you, Caroline. I'm delighted to be here.
I am really looking forward to our conversation. I want to tell our listening audience about you. Karen Kelski is a former tenured professor and department head at two major research institutions, and she has run the Professor Is In blog and business since 2010. And today, Karen is the most widely recognized expert in the highly engaged world of PhDs confronting the academic job market. And I'm really excited, Karen, to talk about this because I know I have so many PhDs listening in the audience. And of course, we're going to be talking about the book The Professor Is In, The Essential Guide to Turning Your PhD into a Job. But why did you write this book? Let's go back to the beginning and set it up for our audience.
Sure. I have been blogging, as you noted, since 2011. And prior to that, I had a 15-year career as an assistant professor and a tenured associate professor and department head at two institutions. And of course, I was also a job seeker myself back in the day after my PhD. So I have seen the academic job market from a number of different positions, a job seeker, someone on a search committee, and then an academic career consultant. What I keep seeing is job candidates making the same mistakes over and over and over. And it's because they don't understand what their application looks like from the hiring committee's perspective. And so when I started blogging, of course, that is directly the knowledge deficit that I wanted to correct. And pretty soon when my readership started hitting the millions, I decided I had better gather all this information into a book so that it was more handily available as a reference guide that people can keep on their desks and consult whenever they need it.
And Karen, I thank you from the bottom of my heart because as a career coach, your book is something I refer people to all the time. And sadly, I can tell you, so many universities and colleges don't address the PhD job market. So these fabulous newly minted PhDs are on their own trying to figure it out. And now they've got your resource.
Yeah, thank you.
So let's talk a little bit about how relevant your advice is to people who aren't academics or who have not earned a PhD.
Well, it's important to me that your listeners know that a lot of what I talk about in the blog and the book is relevant to job seekers in any professional field and job seekers in a wide range of fields, really, because it really has to do with coming to understand yourself from the hiring perspective. So it's making that leap from the self-absorbed story that you think is so fascinating about yourself to answering the questions that the committee really has about you or the person on the hiring side has about you, no matter what they are. And basically, they need to know in a very short amount of time in this overamped job market that we're all confronting in the academy or outside of it, can you do the tasks that are required by this job? Do you have experience doing those tasks? Are you a competent person and a pleasant person to interact with? Can I stand working with you?
Right.
Basically, if you can communicate those three points quickly, you're going to do well. And that advice applies whether you're a PhD or not.
And thank you so much for breaking it down so clearly. I find it fascinating. So many job searchers, as you say, and I see this as well in my practice, they get so self-absorbed that they don't think from the perspective of a recruiter or a hiring manager or a department head.
Yes. And it's worse when you have a PhD because the PhD process, which usually takes between 5 and 10 years, inculcates an extraordinary degree of self-absorption.
It's required, right,
to
get through it.
Yeah. It's a requirement of the process. And your scope gets narrower and narrower and narrower. And the different sorts of people that you associate with, their numbers decline and shrink to an infinitesimally small number until you're really never engaging with anyone who is not almost exactly like you. And so the transition, when you complete that process to suddenly emerging on this job market, this precarious job market, is one that is one of the biggest transitions you'll make in your life. And yet the grad programs don't take any time at all to explain to you what that transition is and how you should go about making it.
Well, thank goodness you are here with your incredible book and blog as resources. And I know you're coaching individuals as well, Karen. And specifically, since my audience is so highly concentrated with women, when you're coaching women job seekers, what do you focus on?
I focus on the two pitfalls that I often see working with women job seekers, which is a tendency to sabotage themselves with a kind of self-undermining language, and also to default to a kind of hyper-emotionalism that tries to pitch their appeal to the search committee on their feelings rather than the facts of their record. So looking at the first one, the self-sabotage comes out in language that might be written into their cover letter, like, I hope that my research will have an impact on the field. I believe I am qualified for this position. It would be an honor for me to work at your institution. And those are all coming from a supplicant position and not a position of a peer, which is, frankly, the position you have to take if you're going to be seen as a desirable hire on the job market.
You do. You need to have that confidence. Would you be willing to rephrase those in a more assertive tone for us now on the fly?
Sure. Instead of, I hope my research makes an impact on the field, you write, my research impacts the field in the following ways.
Boom. Beautifully done, Karen. Thank you. And that's how beautiful it is, because it's simple, right? It's direct and it's to the point. Thank you for that. You know, what I find interesting too, again, in the coaching chair, so many more women are minting degrees, right? From undergraduate all the way through doctoral degrees. So they're on the job market in great numbers. And certainly there's a lot of research in professional degrees and terminal masters and PhDs, but in many academic disciplines, it's 50-50 men to women.
Yes, it is. And actually, it's interesting that you bring that up, because at the institutions that I know, we did see almost 50% of new assistant professors coming in being female, and that was very heartening. But what then we would see is that at the level of tenure, where you moved from the assistant professor position to the tenured associate professor position, suddenly those numbers would plummet and there would only be about 30% women, 70% men. And then at the level of promotion to full professor, it would be about 10% women, about 90% male. And that was very discouraging. And there are a lot of structural challenges for women on the tenure track that cause that kind of attrition to happen over the course of a career.
It is sad, isn't it? I think it's disheartening, and it certainly reflects what's happening in the non-academic world as well, whether it's nonprofit or government or business. So I hope that we can take some very definitive steps to change that. But I want to tap your expertise, Karen. When you're working with women, I know that I hear in the field a lot of women are going back to grad school to reinvent, right, or think about that second act career. What is your advice for them?
My advice is rather delicate.
Okay.
This is a very complicated choice to make. And I know that for many mid-career women in their mid-lives, this seems like a wonderful, empowering choice to make, that they are going to take the reins of their lives and they're going to do a big change. And it's very meaningful. And I completely want to support that energy and that enthusiasm. But I do want to temper it a little bit with some realism. It is difficult for everybody to get a tenure track job that offers job security and that a sufficient and offers a sufficient salary to pay off the debt that is oftentimes a part of your graduate education at this point, even when you get funding from your institution. And what happens, of course, is that if you are 25 when you enter, you get out, you're in your 30s, you discover you can't get a job, you still have time to reinvent yourself and go for a different career. But if you go in your 50s and you're almost 60 when you get out and you now have a 5 or 6 figure debt from that program and you are not getting a tenure track job, you're confronting a different level of risk. And I want people to be very, very clear-eyed about the choices they make financially. Make sure that you understand the job market, understand the debt that comes with doing a PhD, even with full funding, and make sure that you're doing career building of the kind that I explain in my book. So read my book, cover to cover.
Yeah. Thank you for being so candid, because those are conversations that need to happen before one really contemplates a program. And I'm so thankful that you were just frank about the financial reality as well. I think that is something that can be a lifelong burden financially. And I don't want to dive too deeply into this, but you and I know that the academy is changing and the tenure track roles are shrinking. Yes. And a lot of institutions are hiring clinical and contract professors. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, that's probably the statistic that I would like all of my listeners who are contemplating an academic career or contemplating graduate school, that I would like you to know above any other one, which is that over the last 30 years, this is a long-term transition. This is not a short-term crisis. This is not going to be changed or corrected anytime soon. The proportion of tenure line full-time faculty who get benefits and a retirement plan and health insurance and all of that, job security, has plummeted from about 75% of all university instructors to less than 25%.
Wow. And I didn't realize it was that significant. Wow.
Yes. And the majority are now adjunct, non-tenure track clinical instructors, and they differ. Some of them have better contracts, some of them have worse. But the worst case scenario is an adjunct who's paid basically less than Walmart wages once you calculate the hours they're spending and their driving time. And they have no job security and no health insurance and no benefits. So it is really a very dire situation in the academy. And I always urge everybody who's considering doing an advanced degree to make sure that you've considered all of your options and that you always keep a plan B in the back of your mind for what you could do if you don't get that coveted academic career as a tenure line professor.
Excellent. Again, thank you for your candor. So, Karen, earlier you literally on the fly rephrased some language that you were quoting for a cover letter about how a woman might self-sabotage when articulating their value in a particular job, for a particular job. So let me ask, is this something that women should be worried about as perhaps being seen too pushy or too aggressive or too assertive? Is there a way to go in the opposite direction that can be negative?
My position on that is that the answer is no.
Woohoo! I agree.
That's my answer and I'm sticking to it. I don't believe that any good comes from women trying to censor themselves out of some perceived fear or threat or idea that they're going to be seen in a certain way. You can't read anybody else's mind. You don't know how they're going to react to you. All you can control is yourself. And so what I want women to do is just claim the space of assertiveness and confidence. And if a few people out there have a problem with that and think you're pushy, well, whatever, who cares? Because I've never seen a successful woman ever, not in the academy, not among my tenured full professor friends, deans, chancellors. I've never seen a successful woman who is not completely assertive and able to firmly state their position and defend it without apology. And so I want to encourage every female listener to do that. And male too, of course, but they seem to have less trouble.
Right. And I thank you for that. And I'm with you 100%. And I think that's how we're going to move the needle, right? To make women feel more comfortable in being assertive. And I do believe there's a distinction between assertive and aggressive. And I'm hearing you say to be assertive and to be confident and to be, you know, articulate and well-spoken and to not self-sabotage. So thank you. Absolutely. I'm in full agreement. So ladies, get out there and be assertive. So Karen, let's talk a little bit about if someone dreams about being a professor, right? What would you tell her today in this day and age?
I would tell her to read my book.
Absolutely. That's required reading.
Yes, I would, because that's 400 some pages of advice on that question, more than I can summarize here. But I would say that you make sure you choose your grad program wisely, that you choose your advisor very, very wisely. Make sure that this advisor has a track record of placing people in the types of careers that you are hoping to have, whether that's academic or not. Make sure that you're fully funded. You don't take any new debt out for this enterprise. It's not worth it. It's too risky. Mm-hmm. As long as you are meet those criteria, then it is okay to consider going into a PhD program. But once there, you have to maximize your time there to make sure that you're building a competitive record for the job market. You might not be assisted in that by your advisors. That department may be in denial about the need for this training, and you might have to do that all by yourself. But you can do it. There's plenty of support out there. My blog, The Chronicle of Higher Education, Inside Higher Ed, there's lots of advice available. Make sure you publish peer-reviewed articles, go to major national conferences, have significant, well-known referees, and get major national grants. And finish your dissertation. And don't take too long to finish all of this. And if you can meet all those criteria, then you might have a chance for succeeding in this dream.
Sage advice. And thank you for mentioning grants, you know, seeking out grants, because that is also such an important part of the process. And that's what I love about your book. It's really a step-by-step instruction guide to how to be successful. And so many people skip over those steps. And you probably see this a lot more than I do, since this is your area of expertise, coaching these individuals. But I see a lot of ABD folks, right, mm-hmm. who think, oh, I'm going to get that first opportunity. Not until you write the dissertation and it is signed and sealed and defended, ladies and gentlemen. Am I correct?
Yeah, you're basically correct. I do want to say, and only because I am asked this question so often by readers and by clients and so on, that if you're ABD, which is all but dissertation, and you haven't yet defended that dissertation, but you're almost there, you're pretty competitive for a job, actually, if you have the record that I just described.
Yes.
So if you have those peer-reviewed publications, the major grants, the major conferences, and influential recommenders, and you're almost done with your PhD, but you're still technically ABD, you're still a very competitive job candidate. I don't like to see people wait until they have actually completely finished the PhD to start looking for a job, because timing-wise, that usually times out in spring, and you need to start your next job the coming fall to maintain continuous employment and be able to keep putting food on the table. And if you don't start applying while you're ABD, there's no way for you to do that, because the search for an academic job takes about one full calendar year.
Very good point. Very good point. Perfect segue. So, Karen, let's talk a little bit about healthy working life. I dread the term work-life balance, so we won't use it, but yes, work-life integration, right? For someone who is in graduate school or beyond, or maybe on that job search or new to the academic realm, any thoughts on that?
I do have thoughts on that. And in fact, that is the topic of my next book
that I am
just starting work on. And I'm giving it a lot of thought. And I think the first thing to think about is that it's not supported. The integration of your life and your work is not a major value of the academy. So the choice to prioritize that is going to be a countercultural choice that you're going to have to make and defend against a lot of pressure to abandon it and to fixate entirely on your academic work. So don't lose heart and really stick to your guns and insist that your work-life balance or your integration is a priority for you. To me, what was important in getting out of an unbalanced life, and I want to pause and say I was one of the most unbalanced people you can imagine when I was in my academic career, is making sure that you have non-academic interests that move different parts of your being. So if you can do yoga or dance, which is something I do, I dance, nice. That moves your body, not your mind. And it awakens a whole other way of being that will give you rest. It will give you rejuvenation. And frankly, I think it will give you insight into your academic work. But you can't go after it for that purpose. You have to let that go. But I think it's an unintended consequence. Similarly, art does the same thing. Music does the same thing. Sports, surfing. When I was in graduate school, I went to the University of Hawaii and I was a surfer. And I know that that made an enormous impact in my mental health. So anything like that is really important. We often call it a kind of self-care, and it is self-care, but it's also awakening and invigorating the other sides of your mind and your heart and your whole being.
I love it. You've got to feed your mind, body, and soul. Well done. Well done. Yeah. So, Karen, tell us how we can buy the book, The Professor is In, The Essential Guide to Turning Your PhD into a Job.
Well, it is available on Amazon in paper and Kindle, of course. It's available at Barnes & Noble and from iTunes and from all of the other major retailers, including Indie Books. And of course, as an Oregonian, I really want to encourage folks to use Powell's Bookstore in Portland.
There you go.
Which is one city block of books. Ships nationally and internationally and is just as quick and responsive as any other site you might purchase from, but is supporting an independent local bookseller in a time when those are really struggling. So I hope you'll consider Powell's Books in Portland. But you can get it anywhere, including, of course, at your university bookstores where it has joined the ranks of the PhD advice books.
Wonderful and well-deserved to be on that shelf. Tell us also, Karen, how we can follow you on social media and specifically your blog, because that has such great information.
Absolutely. I maintain a very lively social media presence. My Facebook page, which is The Professor is In, is a place where I am constantly on a daily basis engaging with questions and comments and the latest news in higher ed and academia. So it's a lot of fun. So find me on Facebook at The Professor is In. On Twitter, I am Professor is In. Uh-huh. And then, of course, my blog is theprofessorisin.com. And I blog on academic subjects every Friday and on post-academic subjects every Monday, because, of course, many folks are heading out into their Plan B. And so I'm moving more and more into that direction as well.
Wonderful. Karen Kelsky, what a joy to have you on. I wish you great success. And again, I am deeply grateful for this wonderful, wonderful resource The Professor is In. And as I said, I recommend it widely to my coaching clients. It is certainly something that has been a tremendous resource to me. So I thank you.
Thank you. I really appreciate the chance to be on your show.
And I want to thank our listeners for tuning into Your Working Life, where my goal is to help you design your career destiny so it doesn't happen by default. True career and life satisfaction is possible, and it's time to embrace what you love doing so you can do more of it. I'm Caroline Dowd Higgins. Take good care.